so great to meet the families and supporters and the staff who've been a part of our journey with us, unbeknownst to us, so behind the scenes. So, on behalf of Women in Leadership and on behalf of Antioch, welcome to the campus. It's been a 10-month journey with our fourth cohort of women leaders. I'm Carol Tisson. I'm the Women in Leadership Program Director, and I've been teaching in the program, the Gender and Leadership course, for the last 4 years, so since its inception. And I'm joined by my colleagues in the back, Susan Burnett, who teaches values-based leadership, and Jacqueline Olvera, who teaches and coaches and mentors our experiential leadership project. You've probably met. She's out there holding down the fort as people come in. We'll introduce everyone more thoroughly later on, but I just wanted to let you know who's holding the space of this room for everyone. Irv, put that down. It's okay. So just a little bit about the program. We've already had 64 women in the program in this last 4 years. We're just filling the next program for 2018, so if you know women who are just extraordinary, as our cohort of this year has been, and the last three, please send them our way. We'd love to have them. A little bit about the program. Our goals are to empower women's leadership, so to have women step in with confidence to their own skills, their own capacity, their own sense of purpose, and their own way of leading in the world. And also to stack the deck with a pipeline of women who are ready to step into bigger areas of leadership, to bigger venues of leadership in their communities, in their organizations, in their families, and in the world. We're really thrilled and excited about the big steps that our women have taken, which you'll hear about today, and also with our alumni who have taken massive strides in the last number of years in terms of taking on new areas of leadership they didn't even know they were interested in before the program. So it's really exciting. It's a 10-month program. It starts in January and ends in October every year. And it's composed of three different classes that go all the way through that 10 months. There's gender and leadership, which I teach, which is all about both systemic and individual ways that women have found themselves disadvantaged, but then in the workplace and in communities and so forth, but then stepping into how do we create together a more inclusive world, more inclusive families, more inclusive work environments, so that all of us are working together in partnership, men and women, all across all of our sectors of our communities, working together on behalf of everyone, a world that works for all of us. So values-based leadership is taught by Susan Burnett. And Susan, do you want to say a couple words about it? Network.
Values-based leadership is really around purpose, leading from strength, from your heart, from the values that are critical to your success, leading change, and all the various aspects of this book, How We Work with Women and Lead. And there's a leadership model they learn and they practice. So they will tell you every assignment with me, there is a conceptual piece, and then there's a go out in the world and negotiate.
Third piece of this is the stewardship of the Experiential Leadership Project. I'm going to have Jackie talk a little bit about that later on. She's going to introduce both the projects, how the projects are formulated, and how the women are going to speak today. So there's a third aspect, which is really the glue of the program, which is the Experiential Leadership Project. We have three residencies over the year, and then we have online work as well in between. So that's how the 10 months works. I want to have you have an insider's view of the program by actually hearing from the women who are graduating now. What is it actually like? Why did they come? What are they taking away? And what have they picked up along the way? So I've already heard from many of the family members about the extraordinary changes and differences that they've seen in you're one of the women who, from the very beginning, created this program. Raised scholarship funds, because this program is intended to be accessible to everyone in the community. So there's a very strong intention to have women from business, from nonprofits, from higher ed, from the entrepreneurial sectors together, and we couldn't do that without the strong sponsorship of our founders. I'm going to have Susan come up and say a couple things in just a moment. if you've been a donor to our scholarship fund that's made the program accessible, could you stand up? If you're an organizational sponsor or manager who's championed women into this program, who supported them and encouraged them to come to the program, Julie Varela. One of the things we love about Julie is she was a graduate of the program and then nominated the next generation of leader to come into the program as well. So we really appreciate you for that. If you've been a guest speaker, a panelist, a mentor, a coach, if you supported our women along the way in that way, could you stand up? During each of our residency weekends, we have a panel of extraordinary women leaders with whom we come to this and share with us their experiences, and it's really an open dialogue to learn from one another. And also, each woman is assigned to, invited to, work with mentors and sponsors during the year. And these women volunteer their time to connect, to coach, to work with, to help network our graduates. It's just been extraordinary to have all of you. Thank you. And if you're interested in that, come see me after the program. I'd love to have you join our mentorship panel, our mentorship pool. If you're part of the Antioch team, administrators, admissions, instructors, staff. Oh no, there he is. And you have staff. Thanks for also being part of the wind under our wings as we move forward with this program. If you're an alumni of the Women in Leadership Program, as the women would say, could you please stand up and be acknowledged? Family, friends, supporters. Thank you. Thanks for being here. Thanks for your support all the way through the year. Susan Rose she was the godmother of this program. Birth mother to godmother, we've called it a lot of different things. But that was her idea to start this program 5-6 years ago, and she has a pressing engagement to go to with Joe Biden. And so she won't be here for our graduation, but she wanted to make sure that she came to say hello to everybody and was able to say a couple of words to the graduating class of 2017. Susan.
I'm really sorry not to be able to stay for the afternoon, because it's one of the things that makes me happiest when I see each graduating class. So some of you have heard me say this before, but for those who were not here at the very beginning, just a little context. The way this began for me was it was actually 10 years ago when I retired from full-time work on the County Board of Supervisors. By the way, Jane Ferry and Rachel Couch are here, who were part of my team for those 8 years. So, and Rachel is one of the class members. So anyway, I retired, supposedly, and did something I've always wanted to do and never had that was to go to Harvard. Harvard, through its JFK school, runs a series of programs, many of them directed towards women, and this one was called Women and Power. And I had the most intense but the most amazing week of my life, talking about doing case studies, learning more about negotiation, public presentations. And I came home thinking, oh, if only I'd had that years ago. I realized how important it was and what I had missed. So fast forward so many years, I come up with this idea and I start proposing it to various universities and systems. And it was Antioch where we found a home. And I still think of it as the home for this program. So if you haven't had a chance, look at the mission statement of Antioch. It's about social justice, it's about social change, all of what our program is about. And so when I approached the then president of the school and the chair of the board, they welcomed me with open arms and said, let's do it. And the only thing they said is you've got to raise X amount of dollars in 2 years' time. And I want to recognize my other founding members who are here. Patricia is in the back and Catherine's over here. And I want to thank the faculty members for being incredible, because they're the ones who put the substance in this program. And you all, the graduates, have been living with this for the last 10 months. So the final thing I want to say is that, as you've already heard Carol say, we want your help in the coming year or so. So please spread the word about, you know, our program and help us get more students, because we need a cohort every year. I would encourage you as a group to stay connected. I've noticed that each year has formed a kind of an alumni network, and then we're a big alumni network also. And here's the last thing I want to say to you. My request of all the graduates is to go out, I'm going to be a little more severe than Carol, and make trouble. I want to see you go back to your institutions and your organizations and your companies, and whether you're starting something new, and make trouble. Make change, effect social justice, but I like to think of it as making trouble. So I look forward to hearing about the stories and when you come back in the future, but I want to see change. Thank you all for being part of this wonderful program.
And we'd be remiss, Alan, to not say thank you for being the backbone of our backbone in this whole process. Thanks, Alan. Alan Gitterman. A little bit about how this afternoon is going to go, just so you have an idea. Oh, so what you have on your chairs is the program for this afternoon. I'm going to quit talking in about 2 minutes here and introduce introduce Jackie Olvera, who's going to talk a little bit about the leadership projects and introduce our women. That's the first hour of this program. You'll hear from each individual, so we'll have Jackie talk a little bit about how that's going to go. You'll have a chance to connect each woman with her purpose, with her sense of intention for her leadership in the world, and also hear a little bit about her project. Then you'll have an opportunity after those little hors d'oeuvres, so you'll hear a little bit from every person, you'll have an opportunity to do a poster session, so you'll have an opportunity to work one-on-one, to talk one-on-one with each woman and hear a little bit more about her journey and ask her any questions that she has and so forth. That's been an amazingly crazy and fun time in each opportunity in each one of these last Residency 3 graduation ceremonies. We'll come back in here right about 5 o'clock and we'll do our graduation ceremony, and then we'll have a party upstairs on the patio in celebration of these women and the work that they've done this last year. The other things that you have on your chair, you have a list of all the women in the class of 2017 and a little bit about their leadership projects so that you can remember them, you can take notes, you can go talk with them about it, bring them your questions. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Jackie Olvera, who probably won't tell you this about herself, but she's incredibly wise and an incredibly gracious and wonderful interculturalist. So she works with large companies on international intercultural trust, and it's been such a gift, Jackie, to have you as our steward for our leadership projects.
Jackie. Thank you. Store for us today is you're going to hear sets the added access to.
Each woman was required to imbue.
Yeah, it's either the, connection, which we don't have access to.
Or a process that stretched them outside of their comfort zone.
Which we don't have access to.
So you won't hear the women speak about your experiential leadership project, and you may hear them refer to it as an ELP, okay? So your ELP is your leadership, experiential leadership project. Another term that you might hear is Hoshin Kanri. We used Hoshin Kanri, which is a Japanese project management system. We used it as the springboard for the participants to create their project. Hoshin means compass, like the compass that would take you to true north. The true north is their project, and it's also the mission and the vision of their project. Kanri, for those of you who are martial artists, it's kata, or it is, you're familiar with kata, or it's a process. So it's how you get to your true north. This doesn't mean that the women had to achieve true north at the 10-month period. They are somewhere along the way in the process. Okay? And the last thing is the leadership purpose statement. In the value-based leadership class, each woman was required to put a stake in the ground and say, this is who I am. This is how I lead. And then through the course of the 10 months, they breathed life into that leadership purpose statement. So you will hear the women say bits and pieces or their entire leadership purpose statement. The way we're going to present to you is the women are going to come up in panels. That's why these chairs are up here. I just realized I've been doing this whole thing and I haven't been using this. Do you need me to?
Yeah.
Yes, 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 please.
Yes, you do.
Yes,
okay,
we do.
So the women are going to come up in a panel, and they are going to spend 4 minutes describing their ELP to you. I will have a screen come up behind them, and you will see what their leadership purpose statement, the entity with which they work, or the entity that they are creating, and you'll see the title of their ELP. Okay? And I do ask, I suspect you're going to have questions. Please hold your questions, because you will, as Carol described, you are going to be able to go into the adjoining rooms where the women have created artistic renditions of their ELP. So each woman has 4 minutes. We'll come up in 3 different panels. Then we will break. You can refresh yourselves outside, and then you can wander into the rooms, and there's when you can ask your questions of the participants. Do you have any questions for me? Okay, you're gonna be blown out of the water. First panel, please come up.
Celia Wright, and my leadership purpose is I am an influential leader who engages authentically and inspires collaboration for the betterment of the underserved in our community. I'm a resident coordinator with the Housing Authority for the City of Santa Barbara, and why I chose the Women in Leadership Program. I was at the stage in my career where I knew I wanted to advance. I was looking at different school programs. And when I came across this program, I thought, yes, this is what I need. This is going to provide the tools to help me break glass ceilings. So that's why I joined. My ELP is called the Earn and Learn Youth Summer Employment Program. It is for youth who are served by the Housing Authority, so low-income youth. And there's two components. So EARN. We help our youth ages 15 through 20 get employment. It's been found that youth who work younger are more likely to graduate from high school, and it's tied to higher earnings later on in life. So if we want to break that cycle of poverty, we'd have to get them those skills young. But the caveat was, in their application for the program, we asked them what their dream job was and what fields they're interested in. And we tried to get them connected with jobs in fields they're interested in. For example, one of my youth was interested in architecture. We got him in summer employment with Cornell Collective, which is a local architecture firm in town. The second component is LEARN. I partnered with the Key Class, which is a nonprofit organization in town that provides skills, life skill training, specifically for at-risk youth. So during the summer, they attended workshops, including resume writing, interview practicing, and learning about the importance of their social media presence, what not to do online. And so after 6 weeks of workshops and working during the summer, they graduated from the program. My ELP completed this last August. We had 12 graduates for the first year, and the Housing Authority was and the Housing Authority is going to continue funding this program. They find it really important to focus on our youth so that we don't keep seeing the same families come through our doors. So I think it went way under 4 minutes, but if you have any questions, I'm going to be like this.
Good afternoon. My name is Tess Godinez, and when I initially applied for the Women in Leadership Program last year, I was searching for a new perspective and skills that would help me gain confidence and grow in my leadership journey. Not surprisingly, this program has provided not only this, but so much more. Specifically, supporting local female leaders at networking events, such as the Pacific Coast Business Times Top Women in Business event, and negotiating for more of what I want, such as corporate support to attend the Breast Cancer Resource Center's fundraiser. My leadership purpose statement is, I am an empathetic leader dedicated to positively impacting patients' lives by translating scientific data into new insights that help influence medical professionals to make the best decisions. I am the Director of Clinical Operations at Sientra. Sientra is a medical aesthetics company locally based here in Santa Barbara. For the past 9 years, my primary role is to manage the very large ongoing clinical studies at plastic surgery offices across the United States. Through this role, I've spoken with many breast cancer patients at different stages of the reconstruction process. And I've heard firsthand their questions, their fear of the unknown, and their inspirational stories. And what I learned very quickly is that this patient population is entering the plastic surgery arena from a very different angle than a cosmetic or augmentation patient. When it was time to identify a need for this program, I immediately gravitated towards this topic. And I know that many of us here in the room today have been touched personally by this disease. So my project, I decided to develop a breast reconstruction patient website called Sientra Cares. As part of this project, I performed extensive research and found out that this year alone, over 250,000 new cases of breast cancer will occur. And over 80,000 women will opt to reconstruct with breast implants. My vision is that the Sientra Cares website will continue to develop in order to support plastic surgeons by providing an online reference for the savvy 21st century patient, and also to provide valuable safety information about our innovative tissue expanders and breast implants. And most importantly, provide reassurance to patients during a very turbulent time. Last, I'd like to thank my family who's here today. My parents who traveled from Chicago.
to ideas so that I can unlock their potential and they can unlock their potential and achieve the impossible. So my name is Lauren Jolba. I work at LinkedIn in Silicon Valley. And my role there is I oversee our entire global onboarding program, as well as and train up our new hires, as well as run a program called Rock Your Profile. And Rock Your Profile is basically, we connect different members and other folks in the world into the LinkedIn platform so they can get educated on how to use it and how to leverage it to connect into opportunity. So my ELP was actually focused on Rock Your Profile. Is the part of my job that I love the most, and going out and educating folks on the power of a platform like LinkedIn is, I love doing it. So I chose to focus in on that for my ELP, and what I did is I went to my sponsor within LinkedIn, and I asked her, you know, if we could touch two populations and educate them on the platform who aren't getting that education today and who we aren't touching today, who would those two people be for you? And she basically said previously incarcerated individuals and women living below the poverty line in the US. So those two segments of folks became my target for my ELP. And my goal was to create a custom Rock Your Profile session for both of those folks to teach them about LinkedIn and help them ultimately access economic opportunity leveraging the platform. So the way I did that is I created needs assessments that went out to both of those populations of people, and they came back and basically said, here's what's most important to me out of a LinkedIn session, and here's what I need to know, and here's what I want the session to be focused on. So I partnered with two different organizations. One is called Defy Ventures. They work with previously incarcerated individuals, and they bring them into an entrepreneurship program where they teach them about business skills. And basically the goal of that program is to help them become an entrepreneur and start their own business or get a job in a corporate company. So I partnered with them to design a session. In addition, I partnered with an organization nonprofit called Rising International, and they work with women who are living below the poverty line in both the US and abroad. And their mission is really centered around helping these women rise out of poverty and into economic freedom. So the session I did for Rising, I went to their headquarters in Santa Cruz, ran the session for them that was custom designed just for the women in that program. And the CEO came to me at the end and basically said, Lauren, this was the best workshop we've ever had. And I don't know if you know it, but three of the women sitting in this room today are all living in homeless shelters right now. And you fundamentally helped them to understand what a personal brand is, why it's important in the world of work, and how to use LinkedIn, and what LinkedIn is, and that's a big deal. So for me, that fundamentally shifted my thought process on where I want to take my career, and it actually got me influencing executives at LinkedIn to create a Rock Your Profile role for me at the company, which I'm currently interviewing for now. And I want to be able to take the pieces around education and get it out there to the world, especially focusing on previously incarcerated and women living below the poverty line, to help create economic opportunity for them. And the biggest thing for me, my CEO, Jeff Weiner, says that creating economic opportunity is the defining issue of our time. I really believe that. And this ELP, this program, the women that I've met, the community I've built, the opportunity to go out and run this project, which I never would have worked with these populations before. The opportunity to do that has fundamentally shown me I want to be on the front lines of leading that change. So.
That's a tough act to follow right there, Lauren. Good job. I use my collaborative leadership skills to create change and stimulate progressive thinking to assist clients to reach their higher self. My name is Jamie Marks. I am a 2017 Women in Leadership graduate. Yay. I am a clinical research coordinator for a cardiologist and electrophysiologist here in Santa Barbara. What is an electrophysiologist? He is the electrician of the heart. So he implants pacemakers and leads that go from the pacemaker to the heart to make sure that it keeps working. So we have 5 research studies going right now, just about 80 patients enrolled, and we follow them over the course of a 5-year period to see how they're doing with the devices and the technology. So it's pretty cool. I have a 20-year banking career that preceded that, and focused on management and leadership. So what am I here to do today and in the future? My project title is Address the Glass Ceiling. Foundation, the founder is Jamie Marks. And so I really want to take my project and make it into a living and breathing 501c3 nonprofit. And with the help of my mentor, Lynn Houston, Lynn, thank you so much for all your help, ongoing. I really want to help women who have been in crisis professionally, not just in Hollywood. Thank you, Harvey Weinstein, for bringing this to light right now, because this really just kind of pushes my my mission out there even more. I really just want to help women who have been demoted, terminated, passed over, overlooked, retaliated against, and I want to partner with the biggest fashion icon that I know and love. Her name is Diane von Furstenberg. I'm wearing her dress today. She invented the wrap dress in 1974. It is as strong as it was in 1974 today. And I really want to partner with her foundation to donate wrap dresses to these women who have been or are in crisis to give them just a boost of confidence to get back into the business world. I also want to assist companies, large and small, here in Santa Barbara, across the country, to provide gender and anti-gender discrimination training and sexual harassment training. The third thing I want to do is to help these women beyond just donating a dress. I want to get them into educational programs like the Antioch Women in Leadership Program to expand their horizons, sharpen their skills in business, and get them to the next level. So, thank you.
My name is Heather Bennett. I am the Director of Partnerships and Philanthropy at Direct Relief. My leadership purpose is not memorized, so I'm going to read it to you. I am a leader who listens to, encourages, and stimulates multiple perspectives to create better ways to build a more equitable world. So why the Women in Leadership Program? I had never heard of the program until my human resource director, Julie Morello, who's an alumni of the program herself, suggested and encouraged me to take this course. And the reason behind it is Direct Relief, we were in a very transitional time. I lead our fundraising efforts, and back about a year ago, we had 3 or 4 different teams of people raising money for Direct Relief. They weren't really coordinated, weren't really talking, kind of a lot of duplication of efforts. And so our CEO and our Julie and I sort of met and figured out we should probably consolidate those teams. It wouldn't really make a lot of sense to do that. They liked it so much that they put me in charge of it. So this course came at a perfect time for me personally as I was developing my leadership style, my purpose, what all that meant. And so this course has really helped me transform the way that Direct Relief has done fundraising. So what is Direct Relief? It's based here in Santa Barbara. It's an international humanitarian aid organization with the mission of improving the health and lives of people by providing medical resources, so medicines, medical supplies, pharmaceuticals. So raising money for this purpose, it's not about raising money. You know, it's not about, you know, hey, can I have a donation? You know, it's not about that, it's about helping people. So the more money we raise, the more people we can help. So let me tell you just a little bit about my ELP was basically my job, which was super convenient for me, actually. So my project was building a cohesive and successful fundraising team. It was merging 3 or 4 teams together into one team. There were some people that really excelled and really wanted to be a part of that, and there were others who were a little afraid of change. So as part of this whole process and the program, we brought on about 6 brand new staff, but what we did, instead of hiring for a job description to fill, we assess the needs, we address the gaps. What's missing? What do we want people to do? We want people to be able to build relationships. We want people to be able to maintain those relationships. So we hired for that skill versus for that job description. So now we're a team of 11. We all get along, it's really great. But we've been so very successful. So just to give you an example, I'm sure you've heard of all the hurricanes that have been happening and the earthquakes in Mexico. There's a lot of really horrible, devastating news happening around the world. And how Direct Relief can help is to provide medicines to those people in need. So as an example of what we've been doing, in Puerto Rico, for example, next week we're sending a plane load of medicine, $30 million worth of medicines to Puerto Rico, and we can only do that because we have the money to charter a plane. So that's just kind of one example of how it ties together. It's not about raising money, it's about helping people. And so what I want to do going forward is continue to live my leadership purpose, because the more money we raise, the more people we can help.
My name is Christina McGuire, and I am a creative and passionate leader that inspires others to express their individuality and cultivate their self-worth. I chose Women in Leadership actually because of my best friend and colleague, Mary Lou. I had no idea about this program, but I did speak to Carol on the phone for I think an hour, and it just sounded amazing to have the opportunity to be with a group of women that all wanted to make an impact in their community. So I'm currently an employment specialist with the County of Ventura, linking employment and vocational opportunities to the recently incarcerated and incarcerated individuals.
Hello everybody, thank you for being here. My name is Mary Lou, new last name Huerta. I'm an encouraging and passionate leader who advocates for the rights of others and empowers individuals to take control of their future. I am also, I'm also a creator and a provider. I currently work at Santa Barbara City College as a student advisor in the EOPS program. Why did I decide to do Women in Leadership? It was because of all the encouragement and support and love that my family here at Antioch had provided with me, Susan, alum from the undergraduate program and the graduate program. They told me I wasn't done learning, and apparently I wasn't done learning.
Okay, so for our ELP, we decided to create the first Mexican Folklore Go Dance Group on Santa Barbara City College's campus. We both went there for our associates back in the day, so we're alumni, and that was an experience we did miss out when we were there. We've been dancing since we were 6 years old, and there are not that many groups in the community that serve college-age students for Folklorico, so having that on campus was something that we hope we'd be able to provide to students now.
So one of the many things I've learned while working at Santa Barbara City College is that I've learned a lot about the students, the faculty, the staff, and the surrounding community itself. But one thing that really stood out to me was that Santa Barbara City College is considered a Hispanic Serving Institute. So it's considered an HSI, meaning that it's there to serve the Latino, the Hispanic population. While there are several support programs, clubs, and other organizations on campus, there isn't anything specifically to really provide additional support or resources to one population. Our goal with the group is not only to target one population, but to provide an opportunity for other community members and for the surrounding community to learn about a culture, traditions, and art form.
Part of Santa Barbara City College's mission statement is to create a diverse learning experience. We hope that we'll be able to share our passion of culture and being part of a collaborative group, which is so fundamental to this type of dance form. Every person, every individual spends hours and days of practice to create a performance. When one person is gone, it messes up the whole group. So for a student with lots of work and school going on, having that self-worth, self-empowerment in that group, it's huge. It really sustained us growing up.
So going back to when I was about 6 or 7, I have a younger sister as well. My mom and dad decided, okay, we want these girls to stay out of trouble, stay occupied. And my family's not a big sports family, so my mom said, let's put them in dance. I grew up dancing. I spent my teen years and my young adult life dancing. It made me embrace my culture. It made me become proud. It made me strengthen my language, and really understand some of the history, some of the traditions. It wasn't until I was in my teen years that I realized and learned from my parents that it was also a way for them to not let me or my sister be a part of that statistic, be it a young mom, a teen mom. They didn't want that for us. So it was a way to stay involved, but it also created these lifelong friendships. It was through dance that I met Christina over 20 years ago. And to this day, you know, we still stand side by side each other.
So just like Mary Lou, I've been dancing since I was 6 years old. I actually saw the dancers during fiestas at the courthouse, and I told my parents that I wanted to do that. So my grandfather signed me up, and it's provided so many opportunities, traveling across California, performing with tons of different groups, but coming together. And it's just a valuable experience that I'm so excited to share with students at City College. On that note, Mary Lou.
Christina.
I think that at this point, I have to, in full disclosure, tell you, I had a baby 3 weeks ago. My first baby. My husband is feeding him a bottle for the first time somewhere, afuera, somewhere out there. So my life has been completely changed in the last 3 weeks, but this program and this group meant so much to me. I was like, I'm gonna be there no matter what. I'm gonna make it happen. I am an attorney. And a new attorney, newly minted as of December of 2016. And my leadership purpose statement is that I'm a passionate and compassionate advocate who seeks to eradicate injustice using the law, love, and dignity as my guiding principles. So before I was an attorney, I worked at Planned Parenthood, and I was an outdoor educator, and I think that since I was a young child, unfortunately for my parents, I have always been strong-willed and lived life from my heart and gone down whatever path I felt was the most important. Luckily, now it's all coming together. It's all coming together in a way that they can brag to their friends about. Not dropping out of college, which was something they didn't brag to their friends about. But so I work at the public defender's office now, but what has been amazing for me in the last 9 months and part of this program, and it's hard to know, you know, which comes first, the horse or the cart, or the chicken or the egg. In the last 9 months of being a part of this program, I was pregnant and now had my first child. I've had three major career changes as an attorney. I started off as an immigration attorney, and I'm still practicing immigration law. I was down in LA and have been part of, you know, this incredible change that's happened in our country, and felt very much supported in this group as well as in the United States in general, despite a leader who will not be named, supporting the non-citizen community. I went on to then start my own law firm doing both criminal defense and immigration law, and that was incredible, but as a very young attorney, it was also a big task to take on. I then was interviewing for and landed my dream job at the public defender's office in Ventura, so then closed down a law firm. So I learned how to start one administratively and close one down, learned so much. And then in the last bit of time before going out on maternity leave, I was working at the public defender's office and doing my first full trials from beginning to end, doing criminal defense, and a lot of my clients are also non-citizens. So it's been a whirlwind, and this program has really bookended this whirlwind for me, and couldn't have come in some ways at a better time, and in other ways it's just, you know, oftentimes I think I'm by far and away the most like F-minus student in the group as far as homework. I needed an extension. It's very different than what the grades I was getting in law school. So I've been so honored, though, to be part of this group and to experience the compassion from others that I feel that I've extended in my career to serving and being a part of eradicating injustice. I feel like I'm on the receiving end of that in this women in leadership community because I've been extended, you know, time and love by my cohorts and by the leaders of this community when really I'm doing my best, but it is like F minus. As far as being a participant in this group, and it feels really good. It feels really good to be loved for your best, even if your best isn't amazing. And I it's been an amazing experience, and I feel like has only increased my desire to be compassionate and a passionate advocate, and just to know that we're all at such different stages in our lives, whether that be my clients who, you know, are stealing because they have an addiction issue and where they're at in their lives, or myself where I'm doing my best to advocate for the community but potentially not getting my homework done for women in law. So that is where I'm at. What I think I've learned in this through this program, and especially in the classes that when we have been in residency and from each other, is how much of an impact our intentions can bring to something. And I think as an attorney, I was very, very, you know, fighting for the top 10% of all my classes and really trying hard to be the best. And I think in this program and in the last months, I've really softened. And I think that this program and kind of becoming a woman again through women in leadership and really embodying the more feminine aspects for myself of just really like slowing down and becoming a little bit more rounded and well-rounded and kind and compassionate. And I think that that will inevitably help in my law practice and give me the fuel that I need to fight the fight that I want to fight forever, which is against injustice. So that's been my journey, and I'm so very grateful to be a part of this community.
All right, I have a story. So the Dalai Lama is walking around in New York, and decides that he's hungry. So he finds a hot dog stand, and he says, "I'll take one with everything." So the hot dog guy is putting the relish and the ketchup and the tomatoes and everything he wants onto the hot dog. And the Dalai Lama hands the hot dog guy a $20 bill. And gets his hot dog, and the Dalai Lama is waiting and waiting. He's waiting patiently because he's the Dalai Lama. And so finally he says, "Hey, you know, where's my change?" And then the hot dog guy says, change comes from within. So my name is Andrea Sheffernini, and I'm all about transformation. And so much so that I've created an invitation for soulful living. And what does that mean? It means I'm creating opportunities and providing spaces for people to dive into their inner landscape and figure out what's going on underneath the surface. What it means to live a soulful life, or what it means to ensoul your life, is to uncover and take off the coats and the old narratives that we've been holding on to, and finding that authentic self inside of us, and then living it fearlessly, living it normally in our lives. When I was 20, I was going through an illness. And from 16 to 20, I had bleeding from my esophagus and in my intestines. And I was really scared. And I felt a lot of shame about that, because all the other 16 to 20-year-olds were hanging out, having boyfriends, doing their thing. And I was kind of hiding that I was experiencing this disease. And so I went to doctors, and they gave me medicines and great advice, but I knew there was something else going on that really needed to change inside of me. I needed a deep dive into listening what was actually happening. And so I did. I went and I did Kundalini yoga, meditation. I did all these different types of holistic healing. And my life started changing because I started listening, really, truly listening for the first time what was going on underneath the surface. So that is why I've created this invitation. I've served for the last 12 years in my community in Cincinnati, Ohio, by creating a holistic healing center, and now I want to scale that. I want to take it to the next level through that invitation of soulful living and souling your everyday life. And I've done that in three different ways through my ELP. The first way is I designed a new website. So it's a new brand claiming and sharing who I am in this world. Second, I created an MP3 meditation, which is the first of my meditation series, designed to help that person walk through letting go. Whatever it is that they're needing to let go of, they have a process now that they can do that with at home or with a group of people. And then the third thing, which is so amazing, is I've been working with the Designing Your Life team with Susan Burnett and a woman named Kathy Davis. It's a weekend workshop for women where it takes them through a process of designing a well-lived, joyful life. And this process comes out of Stanford University Design Lab and is incredible. It is absolutely incredible. So my invitation to all of you is to ask yourself, is there something you want to shift? Is there a narrative that's deep within you that you need to listen to and either deepen it or let it go? And so I ask you to come to my booth, to listen to my videos, and to take home my MP3 today and just try it out. Thank you so much.
Hi everyone, welcome. My name is Maureen Murphy, and I work for Sage Publishing in Thousand Oaks. And for those of you who don't know what Sage does, Sage publishes academic books and journals. I work in journals. I'm the production editor supervisor in journals production, and I am the newest member of our management team. And I had the honor and privilege, thank you. I had the honor and the privilege of being asked to join the Women in Leadership program, and here I am. I really thought it was a wonderful opportunity to help me grow as a leader in my organization and to grow as a manager. My leadership purpose disappeared. My leadership purpose is that I am a pioneer who approaches challenges with fresh and new visions. I motivate my team by inspiring them to work through ideas and grow through their concepts into viable solutions. This took a lot of work, and I got a lot of feedback from my colleagues about this. So my ELP has to do with something that's near and dear to Sage, and that is open access publishing. The branding name for open access in the journals department at Sage is called Sage Choice. So the name of my ELP is Sage Choice Journals Author Survey. So when I started, I had no idea what to do for my ELP. So I started talking to women managers above me, and we started throwing ideas around, and they helped me come up with the idea for a Sage Choice survey that specifically goes out to journals authors. Well, this was a long process. It may sound simple, oh, a survey, and the survey has 5 questions. But this actually took quite a bit of time to draft these questions and go over them. And I have an internal sponsor at Sage. Her name is Kim Mitchell. Kim is the director of Open Access Publishing. And Kim helped me with this. And through developing it, I started putting the survey together in a software program. And I thought that I could take this on all by myself, do all this myself, all this work. And then the reality of it was that I actually needed help from others. So the marketing department got involved, and they sent me an email and said, okay, Maureen, so we put this in our budget, and we're deploying this in the beginning of November. And I said, oh, are you? Well, that's great. The other piece of this that needed to come together, we're pulling together all these emails. It's actually going out to 650 authors. And that's a lot more than I thought. So members of the Open Access team have actually pulled together the list as of Friday morning. Yesterday, I got the email that said, here's the list, and they sent it to the marketing department. department, so this is being deployed really soon. I'm very excited. And my vision and my goal for this is to help Sage to figure out where to go next with Sage Choice and Open Access Publishing. And I'd like to explain Open Access Publishing to those of you who don't really know what that means. So if you're researching something and you want to write an article, let's say that's academic, you're going to go online and you're going to look up articles. But those articles are going to mostly be behind a paywall. And for you to access that information, you have to pay for it. So what we offer and what other academic publishers are offering is that authors can pay a fee who've written these articles to the publisher, and then that opens up the access to everyone. And this is a really important thing. And I will just explain to you, for me personally, why this is important. Because I discovered that one of the editors I work with does research on a particular kind of cancer, multiple myeloma. And that cancer killed my grandfather and my father. So for me, disseminating that information out to the world, that research, making it open to everyone who is doing other research in this, is really near and dear to my heart. So that is why open access is important to me, and I think it's a great direction for Sage to be going in, and that I am trying to find my place as a leader in the organization to help move that forward. Thank you.
Hi everyone, thank you for coming. My name is Rachel Couch. I work for the State Coastal Conservancy. We're a state agency that works to protect and restore and preserve the coast of California and provide public access to the citizens of California and visitors to the state. My leadership purpose is I'm an optimistic leader who raises awareness and connects with others to create just and equitable climate-resilient communities for future generations using inclusive, innovative, and science-based approaches. That's pretty easy, huh? So at the state agency I work for, we have been working for a long time on climate adaptation, and it's now called climate resilience by many. And so most of the meetings that I attend are filled with people that work for other government agencies and that look a lot like me and are concerned with policy and science and aren't incredibly diverse, but doing good work. And I noticed in the community, a lot of the climate-focused messaging and activism is around mitigating climate impacts and reducing greenhouse gas reductions, but not too much about adaptation. What are we going to do? And so I decided to do my ELP to bridge that gap and to break down some of the silos that I see not only between levels of government, but between government and communities, local communities, among different sectors in local communities, and between people working on climate change and the greenhouse gas reduction side, mitigation, they call it, versus adaptation. What are we going to do to prepare? So 9 months ago when we started this program, those were the deficiencies and the gaps that I wanted to address, as well as translating science and communicating climate change. In the course of doing this work, what I've realized is that not only are there those gaps that I've mentioned and identified, but there are gaps between understanding how to communicate to different populations and do that in an inclusive and just and equitable way and in an appropriate way, being culturally competent about it. And so there's a whole body of work, there's a whole world emerging nowadays about how to work with and do this land use, it's basically land use planning work at the local level with folks that are at risk or margin. marginalized populations and doing that in a culturally competent way. And there's a lot of information out there that just isn't getting out from government agencies or, you know, there's a whole body of work and a whole space in doing that and doing it well. So that's what I aim to do in the areas that I work, which is Central California, primarily Monterey Bay and Santa Barbara Ventura area. So I've been taking steps to do that work locally, and it's been really rewarding. So that's my project. And I chose to do this program in part because I really wanted to learn the skills and secrets and have the tools available to me for leadership, effective leadership. And I was also encouraged by Susan, who had to leave. So it's been a good process for me. I've enjoyed it, and I thank you all for being here, and I thank the instructors as well in Antioch. And come see my booth if you want to hear more.
Hi everyone, my name is Carrie Weber, and I'm excited to tell you about my experiential leadership project today. But here's a little secret about me. I was meant to be a graduate of the 2015 Women in Leadership cohort, but about a third of the way through, I was diagnosed with breast cancer, and I was not able to finish the program. But thanks in part to Carol's persistence and kindness, she would encourage me to come back every year after that, and this is the year, because I'm coming back now with a new and unique perspective that I'm going to share with you. So, through my cancer journey, I've learned a few things. One, cancer sucks, don't get it. Two, there is a wealth of information and resources out there for the young adult population. The young adult population in cancer world means 18 to 40, and there's lots out there, but there's not a lot on the local level. But if you're able and willing to tap into the national level, there's lots of things to do. Number three, I learned about myself. I'm a huge self-advocate. So through my cancer journey, let's see, I served in San Diego at no cost to me. All these things I'm about to say are no cost to me. Served in San Diego, went downhill skiing in Mount Hood. I went to learn how to whitewater kayak in Washington. I also went on an 80-mile bike ride, which including crossing over the Golden Gate Bridge. And I attended something called CancerCon, which is a young adults cancer patient only, having 600 plus people. So I'm not telling you that to be like, oh, she's an extreme sport cancer badass person. These trips are accessible to nearly everyone. And what got me fired up to come back to the program is now I have something to offer. And I'm passionate about connecting young adults to these resources and potentially bringing some of these resources to people, not necessarily they're gonna have to travel for the resources, but getting their awareness at the local level. So that brings me to my ELP. What did I do? So I got really excited and I said, oh my gosh, I'm gonna combine all the resources I possibly can into one place. Because if you go out looking on the internet, it's a vast and wild place. And there's so much out there if you're searching this. But the vetting process was long. Does this one actually apply to me? Is this one I'm gonna feel safe when I get there? Is it still around? Because as we know, foundations come and go with funding. So some of them, they would have a website, but they didn't actually exist anymore. So can I create a massive website that has all the resources? Well, that turned out to already exist underneath stupidcancer.org. Carol loves that title. Every time I say it, she giggles. And they're a pretty good housing for all these different resources. But even as I explored their website, they still had some inactive sites, which I thought, oh man, if they have a staff of people and they're not able to keep up with it, I'm not gonna be able to do this. So I brought it more to the local level. So my ELP is creating customized patient profiles for the young adult population, meaning you live in Santa Barbara County, you're going to be diagnosed and helped here. You would come and see me. I would assess your age and your certain cancer type and then dive into all these resources and what's available to you. And I want the Santa Barbara Cancer Center to pick that up. because currently they're only offered to young adults is one support group a month. So I think we can do better, I think we can do more. So I've approached them and they said, do you know we're building a new building and a whole new thing? And I was like, I do. And they're like, okay, come back later, because they're in a major transition. They have a whole new thing going on right now. And so they kind of pushed me off. They said, we're excited, but I'm really happy to announce that now that they're in their new building, that I have an opportunity in November to take this idea to them and pitch to them, and I hope they find it as valuable as I do. Thank you.
Hi, so my name is Anna Villaruel, and I'm a content development editor at Sage Publications. I work primarily on textbooks in political science and mass communication, and as of 6 months ago, I started working on digital products too, so video, supporting websites, all that. And my leadership purpose statement is, I am a leader who develops the ideas and people that will transform the way we learn. And I sort of came to women in leadership with a bang, I guess. I found out 3 days before the first residency that I had been nominated to join the program, and it was sort of like a split second decision. Do you want to be around amazing women? Yes. And I think it's really sort of transformed my year, and I'm very grateful for it.
Hello, I'm Lucy Berbeo. I am also a content development editor at Sage Publishing. I work right alongside Anna in our college textbooks division, working on psychology textbooks. I am a trustworthy leader who empowers my team to help effect positive change in the world by championing the highest standards of quality and integrity in publishing. And I came to the program very similarly to the way that Anna did. It was kind of like an early wonderful surprise, and an amazing and transformative opportunity that has really taught me a lot about myself, as well as just learning so much from everyone else in the program. So I'm really grateful for this opportunity.
So I want to get to the heart of our ELP by asking you to close your eyes. So I want you to remember your first day at school. Maybe it's college. Perhaps it's high school. You're bright-eyed and you're bushy-tailed. You're nervous because you're far away from home, but you're excited because you're about to turn the corner on a new life. You open up your first college textbook and you flip to the first page. You see a photo of students who look like you, but not really. You turn to the next page and the next page, and it's not getting much better. How do you feel? Where are you? Is this class even about you?
Publisher in the social sciences, we know that students taking these courses are gathering the knowledge and the skills they'll use to become responsible citizens for the rest of their lives. But we also know that women, people of color, LGBT people, people with special needs, and other groups are marginalized, underrepresented, or misrepresented in course material, whether in a cultural example that is not informed or accurate, a photo or an illustration that reinforces stereotypes, or a lack of diversity in video content.
So with this project, we really want to empower our authors and our editors with the knowledge to improve our textbook content. I think a lot of it is just, we don't really know how to best portray different groups, people that aren't us. And publishing is very white. So we struggle a little bit with incorporating these diverse examples. But we want to strengthen our content, but we also want to strengthen and support the mission of our organization. Many academic publishers really just focus on the bottom line at the expense of students and their content. But we put content first. And so we see this project as staying very true to our mission statement. And we've just kicked off this project with a needs assessment survey, but we really want it to be a living, breathing project. And we hope that, this awareness that we're building within our department will spread to other areas of our organization and really change the way that we work. So SAGE's mission states that we believe passionately that engaged scholarship lies at the heart of a healthy society, and that education is intrinsically valuable. Through our ELP, we are contributing to that legacy.